at Sony Hall in Midtown Manhattan, New York City, on a bustling summer night for another edition of Boxing Insider Presents Fight Night. Welcome, everybody. I'm Dan Canobio, joined, as always, by my man Henry DeLeon. And Henry, I love club boxing. You know why? Because we can see potential future champions, potential superstars, heavyweights, decorated female fighters. We have that all tonight for you. And in our main event, let's talk about some heavyweights. Michael Peritone, a Belgian heavyweight who is undefeated, taking on Walter Burns on short notice. Two undefeated heavyweights looking to climb that ladder.
This is going to be an exciting fight, Dan, because we have two guys here who are trying to defend both their zeros, and neither one of these guys want to lose. Walter Burns is coming off of an impressive first-round knockout. I think it's going to be an exciting night.
Yeah, Walter Burns picked up a knockout in the first round just in June. I'm just talking to Lou DiBella. Says the guy has heavy, heavy power. In our co-main event, we have a local guy, Andy Dominguez, a flyweight who's looking to make a name for himself, undefeated, taking on Mohamed Arieti. That's our co-main. I like this fight for a number of reasons. I think Dominguez is a star on the rise, has a really good trainer, too.
Yeah, he trains under the guidance of Ismael Salas, a world-class trainer. Listen, for people who've never seen Andy Dominguez fight, expect fireworks. That kid always brings it. Again, this is another fight with two undefeated fighters. It's going to be exciting.
And in our undercard, we got Christina Cruz, maybe the most decorated amateur fighters that boxing has ever seen, especially here in New York City. Grew up just like three blocks away here in Hell's Kitchen. Love that.
It's amazing. Listen, Christina Cruz is very decorated as a female fighter out of here in New York City. Let's see what tonight brings in store for us.
Four fights in total. We got a little bit of everything tonight, so settle in. First fight of the night is coming up next.
Good evening, ladies and gentlemen. Welcome to Sony Hall, and welcome to Fight Night, being brought to you by Boxing Insider. Before we begin with boxing, ladies and gentlemen, as many of you may or may not know, the Boxing Insider organization and family recently experienced the devastating loss of one Mr. David Goldberg. There are not enough words that can convey the sentiments and sorrow that we're all feeling over the loss of Mr. Goldberg. However, I can confidently say that without his immeasurable dedication and contributions, there would be no Boxing Insider. Before we begin, ladies and gentlemen, I ask that you all please rise and stand in silence as we toll the bell 10 times. Thank you. We love you, Mr. Goldberg. Ladies and gentlemen, at this time, also I ask you to stand once more for the playing of our respective national anthems. We go to our in-house band for the playing of the Mexican national anthem.
Más que osar en un extraño enemigo.
And now, ladies and gentlemen, please remain standing as we welcome to the microphone Miss Stephanie Almeida for the singing of our national anthem.
What so proudly we hail at the twilight's last gleaming, whose broad stripes and bright stars through the perilous fight, o'er the ramparts we watch, we're so gallantly streaming.
Okay, we welcome you in. Thank you, everybody, tuning in over on the Boxing Insider YouTube page. I am Dan Canobi. I'm joined by Henry DeLeon. We have a bunch of great fights planned for you. Our main event, Michael Piratone, taking on Walter Burns. But up first, making his way into the ring, John Garrido and Edward Diaz. Let's start this night.
Ladies and gentlemen, our opening contest here at Fight Night, brought to you by Boxing Insider, takes place inside of six rounds of the light heavyweight division. Our first competitor approaches the blue corner at this time. Here is Edward Diaz.
Thirty-three years old, here comes Edward Diaz, fighting out of the Dominican Republic. Making that 19th ring walk, Henry.
13-5 with 10 knockouts.
So he started his career, he won 11 of his first bouts, but has dropped 5 of his last 6, 4 of those have come via knockout. He's very game, he's very tough, and looking to get into the win column, and he's going to do so tonight in the Lions Den, because Gian Garrido has a lot of fans here, which you will see very shortly.
And now, ladies and gentlemen, his opponent, making his way to the red corner, Gian Garrido.
Comes Gian Garrido, said fighting in New York City was a dream come true. He's always dreamed about this moment right here. So this is just a stepping stone, a springboard. From here, I'm going to go to MSG. I'm going to go to Vegas. He's got big, big plans in store. Undefeated middleweight out of Flushing, Queens. Gian Garrido. Here's the tale of tape, our first fight of the night, brought to you by Adidas. Take a look at that perfect record by Garrido. Diaz has the experience factor. Garrido has been coming down in weight slowly but surely in his career. One day wants to settle in at middleweight, and he's making his way down there. Height advantage to Garrido, and he is also 8 years younger.
Garrido's a very interesting individual because he doesn't really have that amateur pedigree that you would think a lot of fighters would have. Gian turned pro with just two amateur fights under his belt.
Two amateur fights right into the pros, and now fighting in front of his hometown fans. Let's go up to Matt Compensello. Get this one started.
Ladies and gentlemen, this is our opening contest here at Fight Night. Emanating live from Sony Hall, being brought to you by Boxing Insider. It takes place in the light heavyweight division inside of six rounds. Miguel Rosario is the referee in charge of the action. Yvonne Williams is our timekeeper this evening. Our ringside judges are Mark Constantino, Robert Perez, and Marcel Varela. Introducing first, boxing out of the blue corner. Del Congo, República Dominicana, from the Congo, Dominican Republic. El 5-7 pulgadas de alto, y pesando 69.2 libras. He stands 5 feet 7 inches tall, weighing in at 169.2 pounds. Con un record 13 victorias, 5 derrotas, y 10 victorias via noqueo. With a record of 13 victories, 5 defeats, and 10 of 13 victories by way of knockout, te presento Edward Ciclón Diaz. And his opponent, boxing out of the red corner, hailing from Queens, New York. Standing in even, 6 feet tall. Weighing in at 164.4 pounds, entering this bout with a record of 10 victories and 0 defeats. 7 of 10 victories by way of knockout, ladies and gentlemen, Double G, Gian Garrido. We go to referee Miguel Rosario for the instructions for both competitors.
Giving the instructions in the locker room. Obey my commands at all times, touch gloves. Let's get to work.
Our first fight of the night, 162-pound catch weight. Gian Garrido in the black and gold. Edward Diaz in the red trunks. Garrido, as Henry, you pointed out, only a two-fight amateur career hop right into the pros. Has been very active. Four fights in 2021, four fights in 2022, and now he's on his third fight of 2023. No interruptions. You gotta love that.
Definitely been staying pretty active. Ooh, good right hand right there by Diaz.
Garrido finds a home for that uppercut early. Take a look at the height advantage to Garrido as he digs to the body. Diaz is an 18-fight veteran. Comes from the Dominican Republic, has heavy hands, as illustrated by his 10 knockouts. He's facing a younger and bigger fighter tonight. Garrido is finding it home early for those overhand lefts.
They're clearly skipping that feel-out round. Going right into it.
Love that here on Fight Night. No feel-out. Straight leather in the first round.
It's a beautiful combination by Gian there.
Garrido said, fighting here in New York City is a dream come true. First fight in New York City, grew up here, Flushing. Says, I'll be at MSG next, I'll be in Vegas after that, fighting. So he's got grand aspirations. You got to love that from a young fighter.
Absolutely. Gion is doing a pretty good job this first round, stating his dominance here against Diaz.
He's holding his ground, he's standing in the center of the ring, he's letting his hands go. Those are heavy shots. We're sitting here ringside. Those sound thunderous. Diaz is going to have to throw something soon because right now he's taking a lot of punishment early on. What do you think is going through Garrido's mind right now? He's finally fighting in New York City. He's got a lot of fans here. He's having a great first round.
he seems very determined to try to get an impressive performance. You know, he's definitely not allowing the pressure of fighting under the supervision of his fans and family gets him, because he seems pretty dominant so far.
I think it's two ways. I talk to a lot of fighters. They say, I like fighting at home because it gives me more inspiration. And also can say, oh, it's a big-time distraction. On the flip side, more tickets you have to worry about. It's a catch-22. It doesn't seem like it's affecting Garrido. This is his dream.
Not
he's living it out. 30 seconds here in round number one.
Yeah, Gian's doing a great job finding that opening for that right hand. And those body shots.
Corner telling him not to smother your work, take a step back. He is the longer fighter. You do see that often with fighters that have a height advantage and a reach advantage. They kind of smother their work a little bit. Garrido, he takes a knee there. The late knee there from Garrido right before the final bell. What was already a 10-9 round for Garrido looks like it's going to be a 10-8 round. He's up at 9. And he's saved by the bell. Wow, what a first round for John Garrido.
Yeah, Garrido must feel very proud of catching that first round knockdown.
Came at the very last second. That's all you can ask for there in the first round. Heavy leather, probably 70 to 80 punches thrown by Garrido. In the naked eye, probably landed about 40% of those shots. A lot of uppercuts, a lot of power shots. Went to the body as well, if you take a look. The replay from the first round, which was all Garrido.
Yeah, it's beautiful combinations by Garrido here. There was that chopping right hand on top that just forced Diaz to take a knee.
Beautiful crowd here at Sony Hall. Our second show of the summer. A little bit of a rainy night in Manhattan that's not stopped the fans from piling in. I told you in the open that I love club boxing. You know why? Because it feels like it's a neighborhood vibe. You got Flushing in the house. Later we'll have New York City in the house. Christina Cruz is bringing all of Hell's Kitchen and then some in her fight, which is coming up next. So it's a lot of flavor in here. It's New York City. You can't beat that. Round two underway. Oh,
wow.
Unbelievable
wow.
shot there.
What a comeback.
Unbelievable shot from Diaz. He catches Garrido in the second round. Stuns him.
Yeah, it's fair to say that GM probably got a little bit careless in that exchange.
I was just about to ask you. You have an unbelievable first round of Garrido. You're coming out too confident. Diaz has the experience factor. He's throwing big right hands.
Wow.
Diaz is looking for an upset here. Garrido's got to cover up. He's going to hold on.
Wow.
He's getting knocked
down again.
He went down. Referee saying he's down. They're calling the fight off. Unbelievable.
Talk about an upset. Unbelievable.
Edward Diaz from the Dominican Republic comes into New York City and upsets Gian Garrido.
That was incredible. I mean, to come off of a first round knockdown like that, a dominant performance from Gian, for Edwin Diaz to come in there and come back like that, unbelievable.
Well, there was a little bit of confusion here because his glove did hit the canvas, and the referee to our right mentioned that was a knockdown. A referee in the ring didn't see it. That could have saved Garrido some time, maybe took it at another knee. But I think he was out no matter what. I think it was only going to be a matter of time. He got caught flush there about 20 seconds into the second round. We're going to take a look at this second replay. You're going to see it here, another left and a right.
Yeah, there was a knockdown.
Yes, the glove touched the canvas, therefore, look, the referee to our right, outside of the ring, was saying that's a count. He should have got a 10 count there.
So now, Dan, let me ask you, in a situation like this, do you think the stoppage was fair because technically should have been a standing 8 count?
I mean, it wasn't by the book. Like, he should have gotten a standing 8 count. I ultimately don't think it would have mattered, but that's not how the rules should go. I mean, I'm sure Garrido's going to see the replay, and he's going to see the footage, and he's going to try to state his case there. He should have got at least a standing 8 count. But I also think he was just out.
It's also, too, where the referee was standing. You can see that he wasn't standing in an area where he saw the glove touch the canvas.
Take a look at the replay here. Another one. There's that second one. Glove clearly hits the canvas. He didn't
see
it.
No, he should have seen it, though. He was coming from that side.
What you got to do is you got to look over and look for your other referee here who's ringside. But the referee is the one who makes the ultimate call.
Absolutely.
He looked in the eyes of the fire. He's the closest man in the ring. He's the third man in the ring, and he made a decision. But what an unbelievable win for Edward Diaz.
Oh, good for him. Listen, this is what you get in club shows sometimes. You never know what can happen. You never know.
The B-side knocks out the A-side to start the show off. You've got to love that. You never know what you're going to get with Boxing Insider Fight Night. Edward Diaz, in his 19th fight, picks up the biggest win of his career. You going to go in the ring and talk to these guys?
I'll go in there.
Get to the bottom of this, Henry. Drama here in New York City as the heavy favorite Gian Garrido suffers a big knockdown in the second round. He actually knocked down Diaz in the first round. I thought he came out a little too overconfident in the second round, exposed himself, left himself open. The veteran in Diaz, who's all smiles as you can see there, is able to find an opening and then close out the show. Unbelievable. You gotta love that. Listen, this is club boxing. It's not just A side over B side every fight like you see sometimes in the bigger shows. You just don't know what you're gonna get. Here's another replay of that was the first knockdown, which came about 20 seconds into round two. And I don't think Garrido ever recovered. Good on Diaz to pounce, too. You know, he felt blood in the water, saw blood in the water, and he pounces. This is when the referee could have arguably called a 10 count or an 8 count. But ultimately, he stopped the fight. That's interesting. I think Garrido might have a case to bring this to the... might have a case to bring it to the commission. What's everybody in the chat think of that here on YouTube? I have it open right now. That was so quick, says JNTV. Everyone has a chin, but some chins wobble, says KO. Love that. Night night, says NY Rubin. Yes, of course. If you're in the chat, tell me where are you watching from tonight. I will shout you out. Start off the night with fireworks here at Sony Hall. Major upset. Maybe we see a rematch. Garrido looks really, really disappointed. We're going to throw it up to Matt Compitello and get the official time of the stoppage.
Ladies and gentlemen, the winner of our opening contest in 48 seconds of the second round by way of technical knockout, Edward Ciclone Diaz.
Edward, ¿cómo te sientes?
Bien, bien, gracias a Dios. Primeramente dándole gracias a Papá Dios por permitirme otra victoria más en mi carrera y para adelante, gracias.
He wants to thank God for giving him the strength to moving on to this fight and overcoming.
¿Cómo viste la pelea? ¿Cómo te sentiste en el primer round cuando te tumbó él? ¿Qué fue lo que te dio la motivación para poder salir otra vez así?
Sí, bueno, en el primer round yo sentí un golpe en la parte trasera y preferí hincarme, ¿no? Para recibir el conteo, pero yo sabía porque ya yo le había sentido la mano y sabía que no tenía esa pegada que yo esperaba.
So he felt a punch in the rear of the back of the head. He tried to fill him out. And then once he seen that he could take his punch, then he took advantage and took action.
Y viendo la respuesta que tuvo el referee después del segundo round, ¿tú crees que esa fue la buena respuesta del referee?
Bueno, en parte sí, porque el referee que tiene, después de los bolseadores, el referee, tú sabes, y el referee está esperando, o sea, está tratando de protegerlo. Para no, para que no haya un mal golpe y después no se vaya a arrepentir.
So the last call is the ref. He saw the guy couldn't continue. It was the second knockdown, and at the end of the day, the ref is who got the last call.
Bueno, pues, le ganaste a un peleador de aquí de New York City. Venía invicto. Tú tenías 5 derrotas y mucha gente no creía que iba a ser posible hacer lo que hiciste. Dime, ¿qué es lo que quieres hacer next?
Bueno, siempre la mayoría de mis peleas han sido en desventaja. Yo peleé con un boxeador llamado Marte Lucas, que muchos lo conocen. Ha peleado muchos títulos mundiales y yo le gané en mi país, allá en República Dominicana. Y eso es lo que me hace crecer. Al yo saber que muchas personas no creen en mí y yo saco de abajo para sacar mi victoria, primero Dios y después mi victoria.
Well, he's taking a lot of fights, a lot of tough prospects. He's been learning as he's fighting, and you know, with the work of God and the hard work, he's here and he became victorious tonight.
Edward, muchas gracias. Felicidades.
What a win for Edward Diaz. Starts off our fight night with a bang, one of the bigger upsets. Just talked to Larry Goldberg, the promoter of GOAT here, and he was like, wow, let's see that fight again. What a first round, a second round stoppage for Edward Diaz. He goes back to the Dominican Republic, a very, very happy man. Henry, what can we say about that stoppage there from Edward Diaz? Wow.
Listen, congratulations to Edward Diaz. I'm sure it's a great win. He's very happy to get that. But I just feel that the referee kind of messed up on that one. I think he should have given him that standing eight count and allowed Gian an opportunity to regroup himself and see if he can continue going.
It is unfortunate because as you look over, referee here ringside at the table says knockdown. So therefore, you should give the guy at least a standing eight count. But he gave him 8 seconds to recover. He took maybe 5 or 6 blows there where then the ref looks over and ultimately stops the fight. I don't know if it would have made a difference, but if you want to go by the book, then they should have at least given Garrido a standing eight.
And it's very unfortunate because, you see, in boxing, when mistakes happen, unfortunately, there's no going back and correcting stuff. That's it. Once decisions are made, they're made, you know? So I'm sure for Garrido, it's an upsetting outcome, him being undefeated, fighting for the first time here in his hometown, and having an issue like this with the referee, where the referee might have made a minor slip up that could have possibly made a difference in the fight.
It's unlike other sports where baseball you challenge, you stop the game, and you figure it out. In boxing, you got to make quick decisions very, very, like, right then and there, and they have big-time ramifications. So the referee will take a look back and say, oh, man, we got that one wrong, or at least we would hope they would get that, see that. And then there's no way, real way to correct it, too. Like, you can go do replay, but how do you do replay in a moment where you got a knockdown?
I mean, it's, again, this is something that I guess we have to figure out a way to fix with our sport of boxing. Again, it's hard because in that moment, the fighter is probably hurt. So you can't exactly say time out and go back to a camera and watch a replay, you know. So
it's a judgment call.
It is a judgment call.
You got to go by that. But the only thing Garrido could do is trying to challenge the commission and try to get a no decision. All right, ready for our next fight of the night, Christina Cruz. Right here in Hell's Kitchen, you're up 3 blocks away. I expect to be here with another raucous ovation. Let's get this one started.
Ladies and gentlemen, our next contest here at Fight Night takes place in the bantamweight division inside of 8 rounds. Our first competitor, making her way to the blue corner at this time, here is Nancy Franco de Alba.
Nancy Franco de Alba, all smiles as she makes her way into the ring. A grizzled vet, man, 19 and 17 in her career fighting out of Mexico. Made her debut all the way back in 2008. Back then in 2008, we were not seeing the boom that we've seen in women's boxing. Any woman that has fought back in that time is a pioneer in my eyes, because they had to deal with a lot. So to still be fighting today is a feat in itself.
Ladies and gentlemen, her opponent approaching the red corner at this time, Christina Cruz.
You can never go wrong with DMX as an entrance song.
I'll never forget when Terrence Crawford, the pound for pound best fighter in the world, came out to DMX in Nebraska for that fight with Ndongo, and the place exploded. As a big as a stage as that, but still a pretty big one for Christina Cruz, the hometown girl, Hell's Kitchen, where she grew up. We are in Hell's Kitchen right now. She has a lot of friends and family here. One of the most decorated amateurs ever to lace up a pair of gloves. 10 consecutive Golden Glove championships, an all-time record. She also won numerous Golden Glove titles, national PAL crowns, you name it. Christina Cruz won it. Take a look at our tale of tape brought to you by Adidas. Christina Cruz is 40 years old, had a long, long amateur career. Got a 2-inch height advantage over at D'Alba. D'Alba has a big-time experience advantage. But Cruz has what we think is a skills advantage. We'll find out when they cue this one up. Matt Capitello is in the center of the ring. Let's get our second fight of the night started.
Ladies and gentlemen, Mark Constantino, Georgie Gergov, and James Pierce are the ringside judges for this following contest. Shade Murdaw is the referee in charge of the in-ring action. Our first competitor, boxing out of the blue corner, de Guadalajara, Mexico, from Guadalajara, Mexico. Ella es 5'3 pulgadas de alto y pesando 116 libras. Standing 5 feet, 3 inches tall, weighing in at 114.6 pounds. Con un record, 19 victorias, 7 derrotas, y 2 andases. With a record of 19-7-2, y 5 victorias via noqueo, 5 wins by way of knockout, te presento Nancy Chatita Franco de Alba. And now, ladies and gentlemen, her opponent, boxing out of the red corner, from Hell's Kitchen, New York City. Standing 5 feet, 5 inches tall, weighing in at 114.6 pounds. Entering this contest with an immaculate record of 4-0, she is the Hell's Kitchen Kid, Christina Cruz. This time, ladies and gentlemen, we're going to referee Shade Murdaw for the instructions for both competitors.
Let's go.
All right, Henry, second bout of the night. We have a wild first fight of the night, which resulted in a stunning knockout. Edward Diaz taking down Gian Garrido. If Nancy Franco Diablo is able to pick up a win here, then something's in the air tonight.
Something's in the air, all right.
Christina Cruz, one of the most decorated amateurs of all time. She won 10 consecutive Gold Glove championships, which is an all-time record. That's her in the blue, purple, and white. 7 national championships. She is a very decorated amateur, and she's coming right here from New York City. Nancy Franco D'Alba, 19-17. 268 rounds, Henry, to Cruz's 22 as pro.
But let's not count that. Let's not forget that Christina Cruz has over 200 or close to 200 amateur fights. So those rounds, they count.
Cruz finding a home early for that right hand. Looks like
nice stiff jab by Christina Cruz.
But D'Alba's gonna, looks like she's gonna pressure her like a true Mexican style. At least she's gonna try to pressure her early. It's gonna be up to Cruz to kind of stick that jab out there and move her back.
Yeah, Christina Cruz, for anybody that's ever followed her, she's a very technically sound fighter. You know, and Franco, she can bring it. So this should be an exciting fight. Let's see if Christina Cruz can keep her away for 8 rounds.
Christina Cruz made her debut in August of 2021 at Madison Square Garden. That was a thriller card made famous for what happened after the thriller card when Jadakiss put on a world-class performance, taking down Dipset in that rap battle. but she defeated India Smith, who is a pretty good women's fighter who beat Sula Morbina. And had a tough loss over Micaiah Krebs, who is really good. So Cruz, she only has 4 fights as a pro, but she's been in there tough. Round one done. Good round there.
By Christina Cruz.
Christina Cruz pumped that jab early, Henry.
Yeah, she definitely stated her dominance with that jab, her in-and-out style. Those right hands were landing in clean. It's fair to say that Christina Cruz has that first round.
We're still in the ring when the bell rings.
Because she's part of the fight.
Yeah, I don't think she wants to take any punches. Round two underway. Christina Cruz, who had a very good first round. It gets stunned there by D'Alba. Dude, I'm telling you, something's in the air tonight.
Something is definitely in the air.
D'Alba with a quick right hook that caught Cruz on the chin, but Cruz looks like she recovered fine because she was able to throw a combination there and land.
And these rounds go very fast. They only have 2 minutes to try to state their dominance and prove to the judges that they deserve the round.
2-minute rounds in women's boxing, which makes things really hard to judge. Talk to any female fighter, they'll tell you that it makes it hard to score knockdowns. You hear from fighters like Michaela Mayer, says, I would have so many more knockdowns and knockouts if I was to get that 3rd minute in a round.
How do you feel about those 2-minute rounds for the ladies, Dan?
Oh, man, I've gone back and forth. I've gone to so many debates with Lou DiBella, who's adamant that it should be two minutes. I've talked to female fighters who have told me that they want 3 minutes, but then does that mean we get paid more? I think it's perfect at 2 minutes because it generates fun fights.
Absolutely.
Because sometimes you'll see a woman's fight that's the perfect pace, and it's a great fight, like Katie Taylor and Amanda Serrano or Alicia Bumgarner and Michaela Mayer. And you see some other fights where you're like, oh, man, I wish this was, like, 10 minutes. Some are not as good as others. So I think 20 minutes is the perfect time. I know that Mauricio Suleiman at the WBC is throwing around some junk science.
Ooh, saying good right that hand there by Cristina Cruz.
Like, yeah, Cruz is looking to tee off here. She's looking to make this less than 20 minutes.
Great round.
Another
by
good
Christina
round,
Cruz.
Cristina Cruz. She got tagged early in the round. That may have woke her up, but she was able to land a lot of punches there towards the end of the second round. Take a look at the corner of Cristina Cruz. Just her fifth pro fight. Mentioned that she is 40 years old. Had aspirations to join the Olympic Games in 2020. But we all know what happened then with the coronavirus and shutting the games down, moving into 2021. She could have waited until 2021 to join those Olympic Games, but opted to turn pro instead. And you've got to figure she's going to be fast-tracked through the pro ranks to kind of make up for that lost time.
Yeah, despite her age, you got to admit that she moves very well. She's very athletic.
Round three. We have not seen a round three tonight. We're getting it here in our women's fight between Cristina Cruz in the blue, pink, and white. Nancy Franco de Alba in the all red, fighting out of Mexico, 19 and 17. Made her debut in 2008. Do you remember 2008, Henry?
I don't think so.
What were you doing in 2008?
I was probably still in school, high school.
Oh. De Alba throws winging shots. It's interesting because De Alba, like you said, that Cruz was very technical. You're seeing a technical fighter in Cruz versus kind of a wild child here at the Alba throwing looping shots. Kind of like we're going to see Saturday night over on ESPN. Emmanuel Navarrete versus Oscar Valdez. Wild puncher in Navarrete versus a technical sound fighter in Valdez.
That was a great right hand by Cristina Cruz as she landed over the top.
That right hand has found the mark.
Now we have her Franco switching guards, switching stances.
It's only giving me a matter of time. Oh, that was low.
I mean, she's swinging for the fences there, Dan.
I love it. Like, this is great entertainment for the fans at home watching a Boxing Insider and fans here back in the Sony Hall. She's coming to win, Franco de Alba. She'd come all the way here from Mexico to lose.
Yeah, if she wants to have a little bit more success against someone like Cristina Cruz, she ought to rely on that jab just a little bit more instead of just those winging shots.
She's not interested in throwing jabs. I want to throw bombs.
This was a slightly better round for Franco, but still, Cristina Cruz did enough to edge out the round.
Three rounds in the book here from Sony Hall. Dan Canobio joined by New York City trainer Henry DeLeon. A very packed Sony Hall. We've got some celebs in the crowd. Tony Danza is here.
I see an Otto Wallin, the heavyweight contender, out here somewhere.
Love that. Eric B. in the house. Rap legend. You never know who's going to show up to your New York City fight. New York City club show.
You never know.
I remember being at a Broadway boxing a few years back, and Adriana Lima showed up.
That must have been amazing.
I was shell-shocked, dude.
That must have been amazing.
She said that she just walked by and saw boxing on the marquee and decided to walk in. Obviously didn't have to pay for a ticket.
Unbelievable. You know who's apparently been making visits to amateur boxing in New York is Madonna.
Really? She was at Tank Davis's fight over Rolly. Madonna showed up. We don't have word if Madonna will be coming here to Sony Hall. What we do have is a great matchup here between Cristina Cruz.
Great combination by Cristina.
D'Alba, yeah. Cruz is getting off first. She's getting off early. She's moving. She's fighting a beautiful fight through four rounds. Henry, would you like to see more from Cruz? Obviously, she's finding a home for that right hand. She's very technical. there anything you would like to see out of her game?
Maybe a little bit more of the body shots, to be honest with you. She finds herself in close guards with Franco here, and sometimes I think it's good to invest to the body. Sit down on your punches and hang inside for a little bit.
Especially when you have the height advantage and you see D'Alba kind of like crouching over. Like right there before, she kind of had an opportunity to go to the body, but she opted to circle out.
Yeah, absolutely. I think that Franco, she kind of smothers herself there. And I think Christina has the leverage to take shots simply just like that.
If the ref's not going to like break it up and it's open, you might as well go for that body shot.
Good right
hand. Beautiful right hand there from Cruz. Cruz is starting to sit down on her punches. In the books here. Gonna shut out on my card for Christina Cruz. How do you have it, Henry?
Yeah, same, same. I mean, you gotta give credit to Franco here. She's trying. She's trying, and unfortunately, it's not enough. But she's definitely game.
She's very game. I mean, she's a vet. 268 rounds. You know, close to 40 fights in her career, so. Scheduled for 8 rounds. We're halfway through. It's been all Christina Cruz. She's fighting in her hometown, her home neighborhood. Grew up in Hell's Kitchen, just 3 blocks away from Sony Hall. That's pretty damn cool.
How would you feel fighting in front of your crowd there, Dan?
I think I would like it a lot. Chant my name. But there's 2 ways to look at it. Look at Gian Garrido, who lost our first fight of the night, had his whole friends and family. It's great when you win. When you lose, it was a hush over the crowd.
Absolutely.
It was like stunned. The crowd was stunned. He's got to be feeling all sorts of feelings right now, Garrido. Cruz starting to sit down on her shots. Doing like, oh yeah, staggered D'Alba a little bit. What I like from Cruz is she's kind of varying her offense. You know, she's standing and trading and throwing heavy shots. You've seen a really good jab. You've seen great movement.
Her accuracy is insane as well. Christina Cruz is just landing that right hand willingly.
D'Alba starting to lose a little bit of steam. You know, those wild shots aren't being thrown as much anymore. Still game, though. Fired
still,
up
definitely
jab,
still
though.
Game. She's trying.
D'Alba made her debut in November of 2008 in Guadalajara.
Guadalajara, the fight city. Up and coming fighters.
Well, the women's fight scene back 2008 wasn't anything what it was now. Where you turn on your TV at any big fight, there are women's fights all over the card. They're headlining cards.
Good body shot by Christina Cruz there.
Someone like Nancy Franco D'Alba is a pioneer. So my hat's off to her. Christina Cruz with a massive right hand. It goes down to the body like you wanted, Henry. That was the best sequence there for Christina Cruz, and it comes in round 4. I woke up D'Alba a little bit, too.
He definitely did. But you know what? One thing that I appreciate about fighters who, despite their losing, their willingness not to give up, you know? I think that's always very admirable.
Take a look at our action there from round 4. It was all Cruz. That left hook. The right has been lethal, and then she follows up with that left. Goes to the body as well. Christina Cruz put on a clinic here in Hell's Kitchen.
It's a pretty one-sided performance so far. Round number 7. Let's go.
7?
I believe so.
Or 6.
6, sorry.
Henry wants to go home. He's ready to pack it up and head home. Schedule for 8, Christina Cruz in the pink, teal, white trunks, decorated amateur. All sorts of records as an amateur. Putting on a show for her hometown, Nancy Franco Diablo in the all pink game. Mexican fighter, all heart.
Good body shot exchange there.
I like Cruz's jab.
She has a very accurate, sharp jab.
I like to see her use it even more. She is starting every combination with the jab, which I love.
Look at her catching angles this round. Beautiful. Beautiful movement by Cruz.
What's going on in the chat? What's everyone tuning in from? What do they think of this fight? What do they think of the first fight? Who do you think's going to win? Navarrete, Valdez, talk to me, people. I got the chat open. I will shout you out. What do you think of Henry's outfit tonight?
Thanks, Dan.
Oh, someone said they loved it. So perfect.
Oh, thank you.
Under a minute remaining. These rounds fly by, these two-minute rounds in women's boxing. Gives you no time to think. Gives you no time to breathe. You just got to come out throwing punches.
Yeah, that jab has been key for Christina Cruz this fight. Beautiful.
Oh! Beautiful. We had a little knockdown there. Cruz catching angles, throwing punches, landing punches, having fun in there. Christina Cruz, another dominant round. That round flew by.
You know, what's beautiful is that Christina Cruz sees that Diablo, every time she throws a shot, she leans forward. So every time Christina Cruz takes a step back and shoots back over with that right hand, she tends to push her off balance while connecting a clean shot.
Sony Hall packed to the gills tonight. Every big fight should be under a disco ball, in my opinion. We got the bar is packed. Food flowing, there's bottle service to my left, which is kind of cool. I feel like we're at the club and there's just like a fight night in the middle of it.
That's the beautiful thing about Sony Hall, is that it's so intimate that no matter where you sit, where you stand, it almost feels like you're right on top of that ring.
It is a beautiful venue. Boxing Insider bringing boxing back to New York City. Got a bunch of more shows planned for the rest of the year. We'll touch on that later in the show. Round 7 of 8. Christina Cruz in total control. She's in the blue trunks. Nancy Franco Diaba in the all red. Still game. Still looking to win. Still looking to land. Great rounds for Cruz.
See, Cruz manages her range very precisely.
Yeah, she's been in the like the perfect range, like that mid-range with that really good jab and that devastating right. That's how, where you want to fight this fight.
Gives her enough time to connect shots and also see the elbow shots coming.
I'd love to know what Cruz has planned next, like where she wants to take her career as a pro.
Good chopping right hand there by Christina Cruz.
Will you ask her that, Henry, for me? I want to know what she wants. She's going to win this fight. My mind's already going to what's next. Like, how could she contend with some of the bigger names in women's boxing?
Yeah, Diablo has definitely faded in this round. Nice right uppercut.
Yeah.
Good right hand by Christina Cruz. That
big left.
That too. Right hand's been landing all night. Wow. Great shots landed there by Christina Cruz to finish off the round.
Another dominant round there for Christina Cruz as we head to the eighth and final round. I got it a shutout. I'm sure you do too.
Same. I got Christina Cruz cruising through this eight-round fight.
So at flyweight right now, Marlon Esparza has the lion's share of the belts. I'm pretty sure Esparza and Christina Cruz fought in the amateurs, or they fought on the way up to the Olympics.
I feel like they fought in the amateurs. I mean, I would not be surprised. I would actually be surprised if they didn't, to be honest with you.
I can look that up. We got internet here. I'm pretty sure I read that in my notes. I would love to see that fight.
Amateurs and pros, two different things. That would be an amazing fight to watch. Christina Cruz starts off with that right hand. Beautiful counter.
Yes, amateur rival Marlon Esparza.
Good body shot by Christina Cruz there.
Well, when you have a deck, oh, we got a headbutt here. Accidental, no blood yet. Cruz, obviously, is just so talented. It has one of the most decorated amateur records. Fast tracker. Get her in like a title eliminator. I want to see her in big fights.
Ooh. Dalba swinging for the fences again for this round. It's the last round. She's like, might as well.
Yeah, time out here. Kicking a point away?
No, mouthpiece fell down.
Referee Sade Murda, easily the coolest name I've ever heard. He is been a referee here in New York for a really long time. He's the third man in the He's the only man in the ring.
Good body shot by Christina Cruz.
Great rounds for Christina Cruz. This round seems to be putting a little more down to the body.
Dialba
took a lot of punishment in this fight, and in the eighth round she's got to take a lot of body shots on top of it.
And she's got a nice little knot on her forehead there.
The right hand from Cruz visibly shakes Dialba as she holds on. Final 15 seconds of the fight. You know Cruz wants an exclamation point. She wants a knockout. Deacon to the body, hammering upstairs. Dialba throwing back. This is good stuff, folks. Crowd going wild here in Hell's Kitchen.
What a finish.
As Hell's Kitchen's own Christina Cruz.
What a finish.
She's going to come out 5-0.
Dominant performance by Christina Cruz.
A really good action there from Christina Cruz. Hats off to Dialba for coming here from Mexico. And bringing her A game just was not enough. Outgunned tonight. Nothing to hang your hat about. Christina Cruz, I think, should fight for a world title soon. Reading the chat right now. Tania Rivera, I see you. Great fight. Ariza Welsh, Hell's Kitchen. Yes, that's where we are right now. Javier Centeno is the trainer of Christina Cruz. Also trains Xander Zayas. Gotta feel good for Cruz. Gets to sleep in her own bed tonight. To hang out with her friends and family here at Sony Hall, taking a few more fights as we go to the scorecards for what should be a unanimous decision win. The main event is coming up in just a few moments. Michael Perrotone, the Belgian heavyweight, taking on Walter Burns. Walter Burns, taking the fight on short notice, has dynamite in his hands, looking to upset Perrotone. We already seen one upset tonight. That is our main event. We also have Andy Dominguez taking on Mohamed Arrieti. Let's throw it up to Matthew Compitello, figure out who won this fight.
At this time, ladies and gentlemen, we go to the ringside judges' scorecards. Georgie Gergov scores the contest 80-72. Mark Constantino and James Pierce score the bout 79-73 in favor of the winner by way of unanimous decision, the Hell's Kitchen Kid, Christina Cruz.
Gina Cruz moves on to 5-0. Henry De Leon is going to catch up with her right now.
Wow. Christina, what an amazing performance. How do you feel?
I feel great. I feel like I go 4 more rounds.
That was a pretty tough opposition, but you seem to been able to handle it very well. How does it feel to be put on a performance like that in the middle of your neighborhood, Hell's Kitchen, here in front of all your friends and family?
It feels great. It feels great. Everyone's here. I would like to thank Larry for having me here. I would like to thank my fans for coming out and my family. And also I want to say rest in peace to Ava. She's a Hell's Kitchen angel. She lost her life not too long ago at a very young age. And I would like to send my condolences to the Collins family.
Beautiful. And just talking about your performance again, were you satisfied with that performance or did you want a little bit more?
I could be a little hard on myself, but it's probably one of my better performances. Of course, I would love to have gotten a stoppage, but Nancy's a tough fighter, and we knew she had a lot of experience, so we knew that was going to be hard. But we just came here to win, and that was just the main goal.
And now, you know, I got to ask you, in your weight division, there's many female fighters out there. Who do you have your eyes on?
Anyone at 112, any of the champions, any of them could get it.
Do you have any last comments to your friends and family here?
Just thank you guys for coming out and thank you for supporting me and thank you for having me.
Amazing. Congratulations on your performance.
I want to hear her say Marlon Esparza. They have history. They fought the amateurs.
Nancy, ¿cómo te sentiste allá adentro?
Bien. Me sentí muy bien a pesar de que es una gran peleadora, pero estuvimos dando todo.
I felt good. Just upset of the low performance I did, but I felt real good.
¿Cómo sentiste la pelea? ¿Sentiste que el estilo de ella de moviéndose para adelante y para afuera, eso te dio un poco de dificultad para acostumbrarte?
No, pues es que me estuvo corriendo mucho y entonces no le agarré para taparle la salida, pero estuvo bien.
She was boxing a lot, moving real good, and I was just trying to find her, cut the ring, but I couldn't find her.
¿Qué te gustaría hacer para tu próxima pelea? ¿Te gustaría? ¿Cómo te sentiste peleando primero aquí en New York?
Pues es que esta es mi última pelea, entonces ya no hay nada más que hacer.
So basically this is my last fight. I'm retiring and I did good.
Wow. Bueno, te deseo la mucha suerte en tu retiramiento y bueno, con mucha suerte.
Great round of applause for Nancy Franco de Alba. Started her career in 2008, still fighting here in 2023, giving really good rounds to Christina Cruz, who moves on to 5-0. Would have loved to hear Cruz mention Marlon Esparza's name. Marlon Esparza is the champ, has multiple belts at 112 pounds. That's a fight I want to see soon. Cruz has such a great amateur record and has so much experience that you could fast track her. Maybe we will see that one day down the line. We're buzzing through a fight card here, flying through. Andy Dominguez, another New York City guy by way of Mexico. He's taking on Mohamed Arrieti, two undefeated flyweights. Got some guys talking to me behind me. They don't know that I'm live on the air. That's the type of crowd it is here. Everyone's having a great time at Sony Hall. I'm just happy to see New York City boxing back. COVID and the pandemic did a number on the club boxing shows, especially here in New York City. I grew up going to Broadway boxing with Lou DiBella. Lou DiBella is part of this event, too, in association with Boxing Insider and Larry Goldberg. So it's great to have club boxing, club shows back in New York City. They're so important for the ecosystem of boxing. Like, where else are these fighters going to make their debuts and, you know, fight their first 5 to 7, 10 fights in front of their
If you're enjoying
fans
the action here at Fight Night, live from Sony Hall, being brought to you by Boxing
Larry
Insider.
I want to know Larry gentlemen.
He's trying to get me to go interview one of the celebrities that we have here.
How do you feel about interviewing a celebrity? What do we have?
Listen, as long as they're open to it, I'm open to it.
Who do you want to interview?
You know,
Tony Danza?
Tony Danza.
Hold me closer, Tony Danza. Tony Danza's here. You may know him. Who's the Boss? Taxi. Amateur fighter, pro fighter, as a matter of fact. Fought out on Long Island. He is here in attendance. Otto Wallin is here. The mariachi band is here. This place is lit. We have mariachi band, but we do have a Belgian heavyweight. Our main event is still to come. Michael Pertone.
Some heavyweight action.
All the way from Belgium, taking on Walter Burns. Walter Burns took this fight on short notice. Walter Burns has knockout power, Henry.
He definitely
knocked
does.
Out his last opponent in one round. That was just in June.
Moses Johnson, actually a friend of mine that I know from the gym, unfortunately got stopped in the first round against Walter Burns. So that's just to show you that he's a guy that you can't take lightly.
Late replacements are a part of boxing. They're a part of the club scene.
And they can also be very dangerous. Look at what happened with Anthony Joshua and Andy Ruiz.
Ooh, talk about Anthony Joshua. He's fighting another short notice opponent, Robert Hillianis, Saturday night. I don't expect Hillianis to put up that much of a fight, but short notice boxing is tough. Not only that, in the heavyweight division where one punch can change the course of the fight.
But it's to be fair, too, nobody really expected him to do what he did with Adam Kownacki neither, and he did it twice.
A big weekend of fights coming up. Manuel Navarrete taking on Oscar Valdez, an all-Mexican clash. Who do you like in that fight?
That's going to be an all-out war. Listen, man, I'm excited for that one. I think that fight can go either way. Oscar Valdez, obviously very traditional Mexican style. He could also be very technical, but Navarrete, man, listen, that man is not to be taken lightly because that man, listen, he is a brawler.
Think what I love about Navarrete. He has this fighting style that you would not teach. Throwing punches from weird angles off his back foot, jumping at times. So unconventional, which has won him a lot of fights. He's obviously the WBO champion, 130 pounds, but he also gets very vulnerable. That last fight with Liam Wilson, he was knocked down because he finds himself with these weird angles. I think Valdez will be able to take advantage of that. I'm picking Valdez by stoppage.
All right. You can
get that for plus 320 on the DraftKings Sportsbook app. Listen. You can just take some free advice here. I'm giving you everything tonight.
There you have it, guys.
Boxing in full bloom here. 2023 has been one of the best years for boxing. Whether it's Tank Davis getting in the ring with Ryan Garcia, Caleb Plant, David Benavidez, Spence, Crawford, Canelo will be taking on Jermell Charlo at the end of September. That's going to be a fun one. What do you like there?
Listen, man, I think that's going to be an exciting fight. I think Charlo's going to surprise a lot of people with his performance, but I will side with Canelo on that fight.
You had to because there's so many Mexican fans in the building. You wanted to leave here unscathed. Let's throw it up to Matthew Capitello. It's time for our third fight of the night. We're not ready for the third fight of the night. They want us to talk more about Canelo. They want us to talk more about Charlo. They want us to talk more about Boxing Insider. What is the chat got to say? Who do you think is going to win, Valdez and Navarrete? Well, Cueto is a brawler, says Luis Cortez. They're both brawlers, says Sleeper. Which should make an interesting fight. Here's the thing. Valdez was a brawler. Ever since he's linked up with Reynoso, obviously Canelo's trainer, he's tried to refine that because he wants longevity. But I think that Valdez can be brought, dragged into a firefight. The machismo of the Mexican
absolutely.
Style.
Absolutely. Listen, I always say this. Like, you can try to train somebody or do something different than what they're comfortable doing, but Oscar Valdez is a warrior. He's a fighter. He's a brawler at heart. Once he finds himself in tough situations in that fight, I guarantee you, you're going to see an old Oscar Valdez just going toe-to-toe with Navarrete.
Adam DeHaan says, Old Man Dan is the greatest ever. I don't know how that got in there. Old Man Dan is here. That's what they call me over at my John Boy media job. No chance Jermell beats Canelo, says Sleeper. I don't know, man. Jermell has a heavy punch. We've seen Canelo be a little vulnerable, especially on defense. I think Canelo is still damn good, but he is showing a little bit signs of slippage, especially on defense. There he is, Tony Danza. If you're of a certain age, that man was larger than life. He still is a legend, an ex-boxer, had a 9-3 pro record. Always great to see Tony Danza. Lou DiBella is here somewhere, Hall of Fame promoter. Otto Wallin, who took Tyson Fury to the limit. Back in 2019.
He still holds the record of the most punches landed on Tyson Fury.
There you go, Henry. CompuBox stats. Love that.
Let's talk about this next bout, Dan. Have you ever seen Andy Dominguez fight?
I have. I watched some of his highlights over the last couple of days. Man puts together some combinations. Really good prospects. Looking forward, Mexican too at flyweight. We can use some of that in boxing.
Absolutely, man. And to be backed by a world-class trainer like Ismael Salas, who's trained countless of world champions, speaks a lot about the kid.
Ladies and gentlemen, Boxing Insider Fight Night continues live right here at Sony Hall with our next contest taking place in the flyweight division inside of 6 rounds. Our first competitor approaches the blue corner at this time. Ladies and gentlemen, Muhammad Niayikwe Aite.
Comes Muhammad Aiti. Step it into the lion's den, Henry.
Seven and oh. Walking out here with a lot of confidence.
Yeah, mugging to the crowd. Love that.
Ladies and gentlemen, his opponent making his way to the red corner, Andy Dominguez.
Wow.
Listen to this crowd, Dan.
Biggest pop of the night comes from Andy Dominguez. The place is jumping right now. Dominguez, New York City by way of Mexico, 9-0 with 6 knockouts. Our tale of the tape brought to you by Adidas. 25 years old is Dominguez. All right, Yudi is a boy. He's only 20. Both fighters standing at 5'3", weighed under the flyweight limit. I'm looking forward to this one. They have a common opponent that we'll touch on in a little bit. Should be a good one. Our co-main event is set. Let's throw it to Matthew Compitello. Get this one started.
Ladies and gentlemen, the ringside judges for the following flyweight contest are Robert Perez, James Pierce, and Marcel Varela. Miguel Rosario is the referee in charge of the action. Introducing first, boxing out of the blue corner, from Accra, Ghana, standing 5 feet, 3 inches tall, weighing in at 110 pounds, 2 ounces, entering this contest with a record of 7-0-1, 5 out of 7 victories by way of knockout, ladies and gentlemen, I present to you the Golden Star, Mohamed Ni Aikwe Aite. And now, ladies and gentlemen, his opponent, competing out of the red corner, de Ciudad de Mexico, Mexico, from Mexico City, Mexico. El cinco tres pulgadas de alto y pesando 111.8 libras. He stands 5 feet, 3 inches tall, weighing in at 111 pounds, 8 ounces. Con un record, 9 victorias y 0 derrotas. 6 victorias via knockout. Entering this contest with a record of 9 victories and no losses. 6 of 9 victories by way of knockout. Te presento Andy Dominguez. We're going to referee Miguel Rosario for the instructions for both competitors.
Both of you give me the instructions in the locker room. I want you to obey my command at all times. Touch gloves, good luck.
Henry, did I mention how much I love New York City club boxing?
No, I don't think you have yet, Dan.
Because you get to see future stars, future champions, prospects, up-and-coming guys. Andy Dominguez is one of the best prospects in boxing right now. He's looking to make some noise in the flyweight division. Mohamed Ayeti can't wait to get out of his corner. And we're underway, round number one. Dominguez in the blue trunks, Ayeti in the white and red. Both fighters coming out in the orthodox stance.
The pace is a little bit slower than our previous fights.
Stiff jab from Dominguez to open up the fight. Dominguez trained by Ismael Salas. If you're a boxing fan, you've heard that name. He trained Yorick Gamboa, Ioka, Carlos Adames, Guillermo Rigondeaux. A lot of Cuban fighters, but Dominguez is a Mexican-born fighter. Two different styles, Mexican and Cuban style.
Yeah, Muhammad came here to put on a performance, not just to lay down.
So your Ayeti and Dominguez have a common opponent. It's Jornil Borres. Ayeti fought him to a draw. Dominguez stopped him in the first.
Yeah, but you know, it's always hard to go based on performances like that because it's two different fighters, two different styles.
You don't believe in the triangle theory?
Absolutely not.
I don't believe in it either. It's just a note that I had in there. They do have a common opponent. Dominguez landed a beautiful right-hand counter shot. Looks like Arietti's going to be aggressive, and Dominguez is going to look for some counter opportunities here in round one. Both guys are pretty much the same size. I don't know their reach. Maybe Arietti has a slightly longer reach.
Good feints by Andy Dominguez there.
A good feint. Hammer into the body, finding something upstairs was Dominguez. 1 minute to go here in round one. Arietti comes out with a jab. He's gonna want a jab. Oh yeah, he's wanna keep Dominguez up. Dominguez is moving forward, you can see it. He's bringing the action, Dominguez.
Yeah.
What are you seeing here from Dominguez, Henry, early on?
I see Dominguez is still trying to figure out his range a little bit. It's like he's pointed out before, I think Arrieta has a slightly longer reach.
Oh, nice left there from Arrieta. I'm liking this fight so far. Two very game
fighters. It's a good
round
for both fighters. It's a tough round to score there, Dan. Who do you think took that round?
I like Dominguez just off of, kind of walking him down, landed the cleaner, harder shots. Arrieta took, I'd say, the middle part of the round off a little bit, or maybe just couldn't find a home for his shots. He's going to want to jab more, Arrieta.
I definitely saw Arrieta landed some beautiful combinations there. He landed that right-hand left hook quite nicely. Quick shout out to Alexander Serena, also known as Popeye. He's been busy tonight with this cutman role. He's been working almost every fight. Yeah, Arrieta is game. He's game, Dan. He's not here just to lay down for Andy Dominguez, so Andy's going to have to work.
Undefeated fighter. He's 7-0 with five knockouts.
Good right hand by Andy Dominguez there.
And you got Andy Dominguez 9-0 with six knockouts. This is the beauty of club boxing. It's the beauty of boxing insider fight night. Two undefeated fighters who one day want to be champs, but you got to win tonight. Nice jab from Dominguez. Arrieta follows it up with an uppercut. This is some high-level stuff for two guys with under 10 fights.
Neither one of these guys wants to lose that undefeated record. Good body shot by Arrieta here. Wow. Exchange of body shots by both fighters.
Big time leather exchange. I think Dominguez might have got the better of that exchange. He's applying a lot of pressure. He's cutting off the ring. But Henry, it's one thing to cut off the ring, but you got to follow up with shots, right?
Absolutely. Absolutely. Cutting off the ring is only the first part.
Dominguez got him on the ropes here. Arrieta's firing back as he circles out. We got Dominguez's corner right next to us here in the booth. They're shouting out instructions to their guy. There's another right hand.
But Andy's corner is asking him to put pressure to walk him back, walk him back.
Yeah. They believe that Arrieta's hurt a little bit.
It's fair to say that Arrieta has maybe slowed down just a slight bit this round here.
He's eating a lot of shots.
He is.
Still very game in there. He's moving around. Legs are still there.
Well, just good, got out of the good way. Good check hook there by Arrieta. Good feints. But just like cutting off the ring, the feint is to get a reaction from your opponent, so therefore you can then set up a shot. Good right hand by Andy Dominguez. Nice right hand again by Andy Dominguez. Ooh. Good.
Dominguez got him hurt. Got him on the ropes. 30 seconds to go.
Arrieta's hurt.
Arrieta's backpedaling. He's retreating. Dominguez holding on now, Arrieta. Puts his hand up and say, wait. Oh, what happened? Oh. Arrieta's hurt. 10 seconds to go here in round.
He bought himself some time there with the mouthpiece. He definitely bought himself some time there with that mouthpiece. Good round for Andy Dominguez.
Good round there from Dominguez. He was able to hurt Arrieta for the first time in this fight. The mouthpiece was a problem there. 30 more seconds in that round, maybe Dominguez gets a stoppage win. We'll see how that changes the course of this fight, Henry.
Absolutely, but I think that Andy should still pace himself and not get so eager to try to get him out. You saw what happened with Gion in the first round, first fight of the night. It's important to still remain cautious, because a hurt fighter is always a dangerous fighter.
Andy Dominguez in the blue and white trunks. Muhammad Ayeti in the white and red. It's been a really competitive fight. Dominguez has a slight edge. He was able to hurt Ayeti in the last round. We'll see how he uses that momentum here.
And he's starting to put combinations together now.
A stick jab to the body. Follows it up with something upstairs. Dominguez is flowing right now.
That stiff jab is going to be a beautiful way to set up that right hand on top.
Dominguez staying in the pocket just long enough to land some shots and get out of there, because Ayeti is still very dangerous. The 5 knockouts in his 7 fights, or 8 fights. Round 3. Scheduled for 6 flyweights, undefeated flyweights.
What's the famous saying, Dan? Someone go has got to go.
Right.
So far, Andy Dominguez showing dominance in this fight.
So a very famous undefeated fight between Spence and Crawford just a few weeks back. Having a great year of boxing in 2023.
Shout out top. To Terrence Crawford for a phenomenal performance in that fight.
One of the best performances I've ever seen. Dominguez backing up Ayeti. He's got him up against the corner. Got him up against the ropes. Now he's teeing off. Teeing off, but he's also defensively responsible, Henry.
Yeah, but you want to be very careful, too, when you're coming in like that, because Ayeti is getting desperate at that close range, and he's starting to throw crazy shots.
Dominguez finds the chin of Ayeti. Ayeti's holding on. Third round here, a minute to go. Dominguez has lightning quick combinations.
Yeah, Ayeti is very smart for holding on like that, because he knows that the referee's going to come and create that space that Ayeti is struggling to create on his own. There's a cut over Arieta's right eye.
Arieta's bleeding. He's down on the cards. Or at least I think he's down 2-0. He's getting stung here to the body too. Arieta's gonna have to dig deep if he wants to keep that undefeated record.
Good round for Andy Dominguez. I would like to see him continue using that jab to the belly. I felt like he had a lot of success with that, using it to set up that overhand right. He kind of abandoned it a little bit towards the middle of the round there.
The stick jab. Speaking of Terrence Crawford, he used it beautifully against Errol Spence. Took the jab away from Spence. Crawford is known as a good jabber, but that night he was elite.
That jab, listen, that was as close to a perfect performance that you can see from a fighter. Brilliant stuff.
Seeing some amazing work here from Andy Dominguez, a really good looking flyweight prospect, who is 9-0, looking for that 10th win. Once you get into the double digits, fights 10-0, 12-0, 13-0, that's when, you know, like the show boxes of the world.
That's when they start having all these eyes on you.
Well, at least that's how it used to be. We're seeing guys getting title fights earlier and earlier in their careers, which I think is great. Like Teofimo Lopez, I think, kind of started this revolution. Absolutely. What was he, 15-0 when he fought Lomachenko?
Well, it was actually Lomachenko, really, because didn't Lomachenko fight for a world champion for his second fight?
Second fight. Who could forget that Salido fight? Then he schools Gary Russell Jr. Nice uppercut from Arrieta. His best punch in a long time. Arrieta's coming out. Yeah, with a nice jab. Good sequence here from Arrieta. I wanted to see how he was going to come out in this fourth round, and so far, so good for Arrieta.
Ooh, good left hook by Andy Dominguez. Good right hand. Arrieta responds right back.
Fourth round was scheduled for six. Dan Canobio here with Henry DeLeon. It's been a great night of fights here at Sony Hall. Boxing Insider always bringing the heat as Arrieta fires off a combination. Good round from Arrieta.
This is a very competitive round.
Show me something here.
Absolutely.
Flyweight division is loaded right now. You got Bam Rodriguez as one of the champs. Sonny Edwards, they're going to be fighting on December 16th. Julio Cesar Martinez. Andy Dominguez wants to get there one day.
Andy Dominguez dreams of being ranked above, ranked on top there with all those guys that you just named there, Dan.
And if he wants to move up to 115, there are a ton of good fights there, too. I know we're not trying to jump ahead of ourselves here, but
he has a tough fight tonight with Arrieta, yeah. So.
But I always like to look big picture. A lot of these fighters on this card want to be world champs one day. They know who the champions are.
Wow. Now Arrieta's walking Andy Dominguez back.
Yeah, this is a really good round from Arrieta.
Absolutely.
I'm talking about Dominguez being a world champ one day. Meanwhile, Arrieta's like, not so fast, man. I'm having my best round of the fight.
I always enjoy how people yell, he's tired in boxing fights.
You're all tired.
They're all tired.
I'm tired right now. When you're in the corner, a lot of what you shout out is probably instructions, but how much of it is like mental?
A lot of it is mental. It really depends on the fighter, really. Some fighters, they prefer directions. Other fighters just need that motivation, that pep talk. So it really depends on your fighter.
You like Teddy Atlas? You're a fireman!
And you know, it worked. You got to give him credit. You're like, listen, Teddy Atlas is a... I love listening to him talk in the corner. I think he is a genius. And he knows how to tap into his fighter's mentality so that he can get a little more out of them.
Yeah. Emmanuel Stewart, Teddy Atlas, Freddie Roach. Remember Freddie Roach famously said to Manny Pacquiao, you can't handle your speed, son. Some of the best moments in boxing history have come in the corner.
What did you think of that round there, Dan?
I thought Arrieta might have taken it.
I think so, too.
I'm going to give him that round. I'm really impressed. After taking some pretty good punches there in the first three rounds, he came back, stood his ground from the first minute of the first sequence of the round.
Yeah, he had a lot of success with that jab in that round.
Let's see how he backs this up. Round number five was scheduled for six. Arrieta had his best round in round four, won it on our unofficial scorecard. Dominguez had won the first three rounds on our unofficial scorecard. So it could be 3-1 right now. And Arrieta's looking to win the fight. He wins the next two rounds, things get really interesting.
Yeah, I really like what Andy Dominguez's corner is telling him right now. They're asking him to move his head. I feel that Andy Dominguez kind of abandoned that head movement.
Yeah.
He does very good, but if you're going to stay in range to a fighter, it's important that you keep moving your head so that you're not a still target. Ooh, good combination there by Arrieta.
Lucy, I see you in the chat. You're blowing it, kid. That's another great Angelo Dundee. Appreciate everyone tuning in right now. Boxing Insider YouTube page. Three fights. You can't beat that. We're watching a great one here, round five. Andy Dominguez in the blue and white.
Very competitive fight.
Muhammad Ayeti in the white and red trunks. Even this round, with a minute and 30 to go, up for grabs.
I think Ayeti so far has been showing dominance in this round, to be honest with you, Dan.
What do you think? Dominguez is tiring? Is he losing a little bit of his technique? What are you seeing?
I feel like he's losing a little bit of steam there. I don't know. I mean, he started off very well with the head movement, the combination of down. That just resulted to just throwing single shots. While Ariete is throwing combinations and those.
Oh, damn, he's really holding his head there. A minute to go in round five. Dominguez won the early rounds. Ariete won the fourth round on our unofficial card. Great drama here at Sony Hall. Huevos in the chat. Yes, big time. Nice. There's that jab to the body. Follows up some more body work, too. Good sequence there from Dominguez. He needed that. Ooh. Left hook from Ariete. Just when you think Dominguez has taken over momentum, Ariete fires back with something.
Yeah, whatever Ariete's corner told him there definitely woke him up in between those rounds.
I don't know, man. That's a tough one.
That's a
to
tough
score.
Round. Honestly, I have to give it to Ariete. I feel
like he did
enough to edge that round out. I think Andy Dominguez, if he wants to be more dominant in these rounds, he has to kind of put together combinations like he was in the earlier part of the fight. Right now, I feel like he's just resulted to throwing single shots.
So on our unofficial scorecard, we have it 3-2 Dominguez. This is scheduled for six.
Scheduled for six rounds, yes.
So if Ariete wins this third round and there's no knockdown, we have ourselves a draw. If
Going
he wins the round, he gets a knockdown.
Yes.
So Ariete needs to win the round and needs to knock down Dominguez, which is fun. Will he do it? Muhammad has won the last two rounds, says Lucy. I agree. It's always great when you can be in agreement with fight fans. The most subjective sports ever.
Seriously. But that's what makes it fun, Dan.
You're right.
That's what makes it fun.
This is all I talk about all day long, so I find myself debating with fans.
It's the final round. Let's see who wants it more.
Sixth and final round here from Sony Hall. Andy Dominguez in the blue and white trunks.
Good left hook by Dominguez there.
White and red.
Jab snaps. Ariete's head back.
If you're just tuning in, Dominguez had success early. Ariete has won the last two rounds on our card. How will the final round play out? Georgie B, we're in New York City.
Good feints. Good feints, but I would like to see him follow through with them.
Over 1,000 people watching right now live on YouTube. As the chants of Mexico rain down here in Midtown Manhattan.
Other than soccer, what other sport brings so much unity, you know?
Yeah. Melting pot. A Mexican versus a Ghana, a guy from Ghana in New York City. Tell you what, whoever wins this fight, I want to see him again.
Absolutely. Listen. Regardless of who wins the fight, I'd like to see them both. Ariete's game, listen, he didn't come here to just be an opponent. He came here to win and get the upset.
Ariete's firing that jab, man. I mean, visually, even if they're not landing, it's just a good visualization for the judges.
Absolutely, especially when your opponent is not throwing anything back.
He can't afford a point taken away.
I would like to see Andy Dominguez just try to push him. Put these combinations together a little bit.
I think it's up for grabs. If Dominguez can have a good final 1 minute, he can steal this round, steal the fight. Not steal the fight, but win the fight.
You got to be careful how you use that word steal there, Dan.
Rob, steal, duck, explode. All the boxing buzz terms. Nice right from Dominguez. Final minute, knocks good. The mouthpiece out of Ariete. Ariete's on his bike. As the referee stops the action.
That's a momentum kill there by the referee.
What are we doing there? It didn't come out accidentally. It came out from a punch. Dominguez is poised. He's looking at his corner. He's got under 30 seconds. He had a moment there. Another left hand from Dominguez.
Good left hook.
And Arrieta fires back with a right. They're trading here in the final 30 seconds.
Good right hand by Andy there.
Shout out to both these fighters, man. Muhammad Arrieta making Ghana proud. Andy Dominguez, born in Mexico. Had a tough upbringing, moved here when he was 10 years old. Wants to be a champ one day. He'll remember this fight.
Great round. You know, I love these kind of fights for prospects because these are the type of fights that show you what the prospect has. You don't want easy fights where prospects just go in and knock out their opponent and an easy win. No, you want these type of fights that are going to challenge your fighter. And you got to give credit to Arrieta. Got to give credit to Dominguez. They both challenged each other tonight, for sure.
Couldn't agree more, Henry. That's what it's all about. Two undefeated fighters who have a common goal of one day being a world champ. But you got to square off first. Survival of the fittest, right?
Survival of the fittest, man. And even though the fight is over, the corners are now fighting to see who can celebrate the best.
Well, they had Arrieta went on the shoulders of his trainer, and he's quickly told to come down. Dominguez got his cowboy hat on. Larry Goldberg, our promoter of note in the ring, very happy because that was a great fight.
It was a phenomenal fight.
Henry's going to go up into the ring and talk to the winner. Chat's loving it. Prime Point Media says him and Fernando Salas make a great team. Couldn't agree more. Fernando Salas, one of the best trainers in boxing. Watch it be a split decision, says Laura Jaziel. Maybe. You might be able to, it depends on those first three rounds. I thought Dominguez won the first three rounds pretty clearly. But if you were able to give final round for Arrieta early, he could win three rounds in this fight. I am really interested to see how they scored this one. Great fight for Andy, says Orville Crooks. Maximum headroom. Welcome. Just tuning in. Arrieta won. UD for Andy. Draw. I'm reading the chat right now. Over 1,000 of you packed into the chat. Probably another 1,000 more here in attendance. What has been a great night of fights. Andy Dominguez and Muhammad Arrieta put on a show. Flyweights. I love the flyweights. I love that boxing is embracing the smaller weights. It started with Chocolatito, Superfly Division over there on HBO when they were still broadcasting boxing, and it's continued today, whether it's Bam Rodriguez, Sonny Edwards, Nyawa Inoue, Stephen Fulton, Benito Donaire, all guys under 130 pounds that are really good fighters. All right, scorecards are tabulated. Both fighters think they won. That's always the signs of a good fight. Let's throw it up to Matthew Capizzello.
Ladies and gentlemen, after six grueling rounds, we go to the ringside judges' scorecards. Judge James Pierce scores the bout in even 57 to 57. Robert Perez and Marcel Varela scored about 58 to 56 in favor of the winner by way of majority decision, Andy Dominguez.
Andy Dominguez moves on to 10-0. a majority decision. One of the judges had it a draw. I'm okay with that. I thought Urieti won those middle rounds. If he stole one of the early rounds, then you got yourselves a draw. I think Dominguez won the fight. I thought he won the final round. Dominguez moves on. Do want to see Urieti fight on again. Great action fight at flyweight. Dominguez is standing by with Henry.
Andy Dominguez. Andy Dominguez, wow. What an amazing performance. Did you expect for it to be that difficult that it was tonight?
I mean, I didn't sleep on him. I already know he's hungry as well. I definitely have a lot to work on, but I feel like I won. I landed the harder punches. I connected way better punches. He was throwing a lot, but he wasn't hitting me.
What would you rate your performance tonight?
Man, I've been off for a long time. I would say from 1 to 10, man, I gotta say a 7.
A 7. Well, listen, man, that was a very competitive fight that you both had. What do you want to do next?
Man, whatever my team says, whatever they have for me, it was definitely a good comeback. I fought 7-0, 1 draw. I feel like I could have been better, but I couldn't sleep on him, man.
Listen, man, look at the crowd. Look around you. You had a crowd out here tonight. What do you want to say to them?
Thank you, man. This is New York. This is my home, man. I feel it feels great, right, coming out the entrance. I hear the whole people just screaming my name. You know, I get the nerves hit, but it feels good. Good nerves.
And my last question, Andy, when can we expect you back?
When can they expect me back? Definitely this year, man. I gotta do one more. And one thing, man, I wanted to dedicate this fight to David Goldberg. And I appreciate everything Larry does for me. He's a great, great promoter. And I just, this is from the WBA, Gilberto Mendoza. I just wanted to say rest in peace to your father. I met him a couple times. And he's been nothing but such a great person. And this is for you, man. He created a nice person, too.
Okay, Mohammed, how are you feeling?
All right, first of all, I'd like to thank God Almighty for this great opportunity. And I also like to thank my team, especially my manager, CEO of Wimbase Boxing Promotions. And I think the decision is no, you know, I feel I won the fight. When you like, we have to do it again. I'm ready. I'm ready to do it again because I don't take this decision, you know, I don't take it. So we can do it again whenever they are ready. But I mean, I'm ready. I want to do it again.
You got cut in the middle of rounds. Did that cut affect you at all?
No, the cut things are elbow, you know. The cut is an elbow. And I don't think this cut could do me anything. You could see the fight. I'm still keeping, you know. I'm still jabbing. I'm going. So I wanted to do it again. I'm ready. Let's do it again. If they think they've won, let's do it again.
Was Andy Dominguez a harder opponent than you had anticipated?
I think Andy is a good boxer, but, you know, it's not for my style. Andy can definitely defend me as usual. You know, so let's do it again. I'm ready to do it again.
And if you would like to run it again, how soon would you like to have that rematch?
Oh, okay. It's up to them. But I mean, I want to do it again. If they think they are champion, let's do it again.
And now, you fought here in the middle of Times Square in front of an amazing crowd. What was that like?
Oh, man, you know, I know I'm from Africa, so in the ring, nobody fight for him, you know. He fight alone, I also fight alone. So, you know, I don't think the crowd and anything could do me nothing. You know?
Well, congratulations on a tremendous performance.
The fight of the night, you just witnessed it. Andy Dominguez moves to 10-0. Mohammed Urieti, tough luck loser. 7-1. With one draw now. I thought it was a good fight. I thought Dominguez narrowly won the fight. One judge had it a draw. DH, I see you in the chat. I was personally invited by Kenobi. Yes, I've been personally invited my friends to join the chat. Good fight. Arrieta just walks by the broadcast booth. That's what I love about these fans here in New York City, too. They will cheer the winner, and also cheer the loser, the guy at the B-side, the guy who came in into the Lions' Den. This is a Dominguez crowd, but he gave Dominguez a really good fight. Arrieta, but Dominguez moves on. A really good-looking flyweight, wants to work on some more things. Gave himself a C-plus. I think that's pretty accurate. I thought he came out hot. He was throwing a lot of combinations early. Lost a little bit of steam on those punches. And then finished strong. I'm sure he wants to do better. Still has a long ways to go before he can contend for a title, but a really good win. So it's all about survive and advance. And Jason Dominguez did that. We're setting ourselves up for our main event. It's here, heavyweights. We saved the biggest for the last, Henry.
Wow.
That was an awesome post-fight, man. You're doing a great job.
Oh, thank you, Dan. Listen, man. Muhammad's over there talking about a rematch. I would not be mad to watch it again. I wouldn't.
I was fine with the scorecards. I draw, especially if you would have given Arrieta one of those first three rounds.
Absolutely.
But he won the middle two rounds. So that's three rounds right there. I was fine with the Dominguez decision because I thought Dominguez won the final round.
Absolutely.
So I thought the judging was great, but the fight was great. Fight of the night by far.
For sure, for sure. And like I said, I wouldn't be upset watching that fight again.
Andy Dominguez making his way back into the locker room. He's all smiles. Would you agree with the assessment, though, that he gave himself, what, a C?
He gave himself a C performance, and you know what? I've seen Andy fight a couple times, and, like, I would agree with his rate because I feel like...
Red corner, here is Mike Piraton.
Michael Piraton, a Belgian heavyweight, undefeated heavyweight, 7-0 with four knockouts. Got it to boxing late. Standout athlete. Here is the tail tape for our main event. The Azad brand brings us this one. Both fighters undefeated. 5-inch. Height advantage for Piraton. Walter Burns is 41, but don't let that fool you. Heavyweights can fight into their 40s. The last thing to go is power. I'm ready to go here in New York City. Dan Canobio, Henry De Leon, we're ready for our main event of the night in the heavyweight division.
Ladies and gentlemen, the following contest is our main event of the evening here at Fight Night, brought to you by Boxing Insider in association with DiBella Entertainment. It takes place in the heavyweight division inside of 8 rounds. Mark Constantino, Georgi Gergov, and Robert Perez are the ringside judges. Also ringside from the New York State Athletic Commission present is Matt Delalio. Sade Murdaw is the referee in charge of the action. Ladies and gentlemen, are you ready? Turn it up louder, ladies and gentlemen, let's go! Introducing first, boxing out of the blue corner, from Belleville, Michigan, standing in even 6 feet tall, weighing in at 212 pounds, 6 ounces, he enters this bout with an immaculate record of 7-0, 5 out of 7 victories by way of knockout. Ladies and gentlemen, Walter Third Degree Burns. Ladies and gentlemen, his opponent, hailing from Liège, Belgium. He stands 6 feet 5 inches tall, weighing in at 231 pounds, 8 ounces. Also entering this contest with an immaculate record of 7-0 with 3 out of 7 victories by way of knockout. Here is Mike Bomaye Piraton. We now go to referee Sade Murdaw for the instructions for both competitors.
we go, Henry. Well, we're all gathered here. There's something about a heavyweight fight that gets the blood flowing.
When I call for the break, give me the clean break. Touch him up. Let's go.
The big boys. Henry, I'm ready.
Yeah. For a moment there, when Andy Dominguez was in there, that ring looked big. Now these guys are in here, that ring looks a lot smaller now.
The big boys, Michael Peratone in the purple trunks, Walter Burns in the red trunks. Walter Burns has a look on his face right now.
He means business.
I want to crush you, Michael Peratone. I'm a little scared. I'm a little intimidated, not gonna lie.
That is definitely an intimidating look by Walter Burns.
Walter Burns comes out with a very stiff jab to the body. Peratone, you know, talking to him yesterday in your fighter meeting, says he knows this guy's heavy-handed. He knows he's coming off of a big knockout. That he just has to be defensive-minded and has to move around in there. He's a mover by nature, Peratone.
So far standing in front of Burns.
Burns with a looping left hook that misses the mark. Burns, 41 years old, but has 7 pro fights, and 5 of those have been come by stoppage. Just this June, he had a KO1 over Moses Johnson. He had another big stoppage in 2010 in the first round.
Yeah, Burns is no stranger to fighting undefeated fighters.
Got 4 first-round knockouts.
Incredible. So that's the thing about heavyweights, exactly. It can happen at any second.
Peratone, Belgian heavyweight. Real renaissance man. I got to called one of his fights in Detroit. Got to talk to him a little bit. He's a thinker in there. He enjoys a lot of things that your non-traditional heavyweight would enjoy. A lot of swag, too. Peratone 7-0 with 3 knockouts. Had 2 fights in 2023. It's his first fight of 2023. I know he wants to be more active.
Yeah, Peron yesterday at the fighters meeting said that his best attribute is his legs. So far I've seen him comfortably standing in front of Burns.
Yeah, I'm surprised by that, because one thing I did remember from calling his fight back in Detroit was him moving. It's so graceful. I think he's put on more weight, which is probably a good thing. So maybe the weight is he's changing up his style a little bit, standing in the center. Not throwing too many punches, though.
Yeah, Burns isn't doing really much to try to set up that right hand over the top that he keeps looking for. He was throwing jabs to the belly in the beginning, but right now he's just resorting to just looking for that right hand.
I love the facial expressions of Burns. He kind of is like, really? That's what you're going to throw at me? Come on now. Final remaining seconds here of a prototypical feeling out round. Round one, I expect things to pick up a little bit more as Burns goes on the offensive here to end round one.
Slow round first to start off the fight.
Give that one to Peratone?
I'll give that round to Burns. I didn't see Peratone really let his hands go much. And yes, Burns wasn't throwing the most prettiest shots, but he was slightly bit more effective, especially in the earlier of the round with that jab to the belly.
Both guys maybe are better off as counter punchers. That could obviously make for a slow action.
Burns is definitely swinging for the fences, so I'm curious to see if he's going to be able to carry that stamina for the remainder of the fight. Because he's swinging for the fence and he's not exactly landing, and that takes quite a toll on you when you miss those type of shots.
Round two underway. Heavyweight division, our main event. Michael Peratone in the purple and white trunks. Walter Burns.
Nice little right hand there by Burns over the top.
Here we go. A little leather being thrown early on. We kind of went over what Peroton does well. What do you want to see more of here from Burns?
I would like to see him try to set up that right hand up a little bit better. Don't get desperate trying to find it, find a home for it. Take your time. Set him up. Set him up. I mean, heavyweights don't really throw combinations. They usually tend to throw a lot of single shots. So develop that pattern of setting up, of using single shots to then eventually throw in two or three shots.
Burns lands a nice right hand. Peroton holds on. Peroton doesn't look too... Oh, a nice,
ooh, nice
right there
hand
from Burns. Follows up with another one. Peroton fires back. One of the best exchanges of the fight so far. Burns so flat-footed. Just waiting for Peroton to go first. And I don't know if that's Piriton's strength, you know? Someone's got to be first, right?
You can definitely tell that Peroton acknowledges Burns' power because it's making him a little trigger shy there.
Big right there from Peroton. Like that there, ooh, for Peroton. The referee allowed them in the clinch. Peroton took a step back and fired off a combination. But in fighting, fighting in the clinch is such a big part of heavyweight boxing.
Peroton has great distance from where he's standing, but I wish he would just use that jab just a little bit more. I mean, you don't have to throw knockout shots. Score points. He's standing in range. Score points.
Yeah, he's not firing a lot of shots. I would say both guys are throwing under 30 punches a round. You know, the heavyweight average is around 45 to 50. Burns,
ooh, good right-handed by Burns.
Yeah, but he got countered by Peroton, too. When Burns opens up, which he has to do to win the fight, Peroton is a really good counterpuncher, or has shown that at least so far. So you can kind of see something developing here, patterns developing here. Burns kind of opening up, not so often, and Peroton looking for openings.
Good competitive round from both guys.
Action that was from a round
good,
two.
Good counter by Peroton right there.
Yeah, Piriton's a good counterpuncher, man.
I just feel like he's not letting his hands go enough.
He's not going to be first. That's a problem. When you have a guy in Burns, he's definitely not going to be first. It's kind of two counterpunchers kind of staring at each other.
But at least Burns is taking the risk by stepping inside with those looping shots.
Dominguez making his way back from the locker room. Hasn't even changed yet. Still in his trunks. Underway. Michael Peroton, the Belgian heavyweight in the purple and white.
Peroton using that, putting a little bit more use to that jab this round.
Peroton is the more active of the two. Walter Burns looking for an opening, looking for a knockout. He's a knockout fighter. He fought just last month and picked up a KO once. Five knockouts, five first round knockouts. Peroton is a little more calculated of a fighter. Even though in this fight,
I got down
to the body, too.
This is a better round for Peroton.
When he lets his hands go, man, he finds a home for him. But you know who's also here in attendance? Are you a Sopranos fan?
I love the Sopranos.
Furio Gianta.
Oh, look at that.
The former muscle of Tony Soprano. Met his demise by having some type of a love affair with Carmella. I'm talking Sopranos here in the middle of a heavyweight fight. Furio is here. I know he's a big boxing fan. He used to come a lot of HBO fights back in the day.
Yeah, Kiritone's definitely having a little bit more success this round.
Yeah, Kiritone's starting to up the pace a little bit. It's a slow pace, and he's upping it. Burns really not being able to find sucking wind.
Yeah, Burns looks like he might have hurt himself there.
Might have hurt his arm, extended it.
He also seems to be a little bit more winded now, too, to be honest with you, Dan.
So maybe Kiritone had a game plan here. As I'm going to come out early. I'm not going to throw a lot of
punches. He did say that, actually, yesterday. The fighters meeting that he was going to weather the storm in the beginning.
Now he's dancing. He's getting cocky. Firing jabs.
I wouldn't call that cocky, Dan. I call that throwing your opponent off a bit, you know?
Okay. Oh, nice right from Kiritone. But he kind of smothers it. Final 20 seconds here. It's been a really good round for Kiritone.
Very good round.
Burns, better find something soon. Late replacement guy. Looks in decent shape.
I don't know. I would say that he's definitely gassed.
I mean, just visibly.
I don't know if it's
sucking wind. I don't know if it's a sucking wind or it's an injury.
I don't know if it's the pain of trying to catch his breath or that arm he seems to be shaking out. There, look, he's holding it now.
Good round for Kiritone. His best round. His most demonstrative round. Let's see how Kiritone comes out in this next round. Uses the momentum. Let's see how Burns reacts. Taking a good punches there in round three.
Yeah, I think if Kiritone can pick up on the fact that, oh, wait a minute.
He's stopping the fight. That's it, folks. We thought we saw an injury.
And it seems like Burns isn't able to continue because of that arm.
The fans know. They're not reacting. Kiritone knows because he's dancing. This fight's over, folks. Michael Kiritone is going to move on to 8-0. As Walter Burns is unable to come off his stool. It's his arm. He's holding his left arm. Walter Burns is a very, very tough guy. But if he can't continue, he must be in a lot of pain.
Absolutely. I mean, to be undefeated in that sense and then just stop fighting because of your arm, it must be a serious injury.
Henry, I think they're going to put me and you in the ring next.
Uh-oh.
A walkout bout.
Exhibition bout.
You know what this creator clash, have you heard of that?
No, what is that?
It's like a bunch of YouTubers that fight. Oh. It's not like the one you see on DAZN, the Misfits one.
It's entertaining.
And I'm in the creator world on YouTube. I've been asked.
Okay.
I've been asked, would you consider it?
Now, let me ask you, would you consider it?
No. I like my face too much. But I would hire you, and I would hire Chris Algieri as my trainers.
Let's do it. It'd be an honor to work with Chris.
Creator clash, here I come. Michael Kiritone. Very happy man, moves on to 8-0. Walter Burns took the fight on short notice, suffers the first loss of his career.
Listen, despite it being a short card, there were some exciting fights. We had one major upset. Andy Dominguez versus Muhammad Ariete was a very competitive bout.
Fight of the night.
Cristina Cruz came in here and showed nothing but skill. I'd say it was a good night of boxing, Dan.
No, it was great, man. Four or five fights, good pace, good crowd. We had some back and forth stuff. We had an unbelievable upset in the first fight of the night. Edward Diaz.
That was definitely moment of the night. We've got to give that.
Moment of the night, for sure. Andy Dominguez.
Yeah. For sure.
Good stuff all around as Kiritone goes over to Walter Burns.
We go to Matt Compitella for the decision.
Ladies and gentlemen, at the end of the third round, Mr. Burns is unable to continue due to an injury. Therefore, the winner of this bout, by way of technical knockout, Mike Bomaye Tiraton.
Michael Peraton, good looking Belgian heavyweight, continues his climb. He's 8-0 now, and he is going to be talking with our Henry De Leon. Peraton well represented. Got Lou DiBello in his corner.
Michael Peraton, congratulations on a tremendous win. What are your thoughts on that fight?
I'm happy. I'm going back home to see my girl. And for the fight, you know, we executed the game plan. I had great team, man. All the team back in LA, all the Robles family and the strength and conditioning coach, Matthias, also Edgar, everything. Even my friend back home in Little Boxing Gym, they helped me to keeping up my strength and conditioning back home. Everybody, my family, my dad, who went into surgery this night, and I was in a corner of my head, so I'm pleased he's good. My sister, my friend, like every boxer, you know.
You had a little bit of a slow start in the earlier rounds. Was that the game plan, to just wait out the storm and then put pressure later in the later rounds?
Yeah, just, you know, we knew nothing about my opponent because his last fight was a first round knockout and I couldn't see footage, so I wanted to take my time to know what he's coming with. And I was expecting, considering his size, like large looping shot, and that's what he gave me. So I'm good with my legs, I pace it up, I work the body. I think I called him good to the body, that's why he... But big respect for him because he stepped in the ring. My two next opponent pull out, motherfucking coward. So, yeah. Oh, no curse, they say. Sorry. And, yeah, so thanks to him to step in the ring and do his job and put his all on the line like I did. So, yeah, I'm happy now. We're going to the next. I'm waiting for a bigger thing now.
The heavyweight division is a very exciting division to be in. Who do you want next?
Oh, who I want next, you know, I have a team that I trust. Mr. Lou DiBella is here, he's my promoter, so... You know, there is some type of fighter that I know that's already in the top 50 that I can take already because of my footwork and most of every weight are flat-footed. And there is other type of every weight that I still need to know on the job because, as I tell you yesterday, I have a really little amateur career. But there is some top guy, you know, heavy guys, really slow, really sluggish. I can play with my legs with them, so let's see what's coming.
Now, fighting here in the middle of Times Square, what was it like fighting in front of all this crowd?
Oh, man, that was great. And it was the first time, I don't know where they are, but it was the first time that I fought in front of people from my mom country, so I was really hyped by that. And, you know, people watching at home, I don't really... It's a good atmosphere, man. I like the city. It was cool, man.
Michael Peraton, thank you so much. Congratulations. Dan, back to you.
That is a wrap here from New York City and Sony Hall. A great night of fights. We saw upsets. Edward Diaz upsetting John Garrido. We saw a great fight between Andy Dominguez and Muhammad Ayeti.
Well, there you have it, Dan. That is the conclusion of Boxing Insider Fight Night. So
great
what's
night.
Your take?
My take was another great club show, another great night at the showcasing a lot of these guys. Andy Dominguez with the fight of the night, with his big win, a knockout, upset. John Garrido, I'm sure, is going to want to try to get that back, some get back, so maybe see a rematch there. Christina Cruz, it's awesome to see like a real elite-level fighter. I want to see her fight Marlon Esparza. I'm really going to push for that fight. I really want to fast-track Christina Cruz. Get her a world title shot, damn it. That's my thoughts.
Now let me ask you, Dan, this is Boxing Inside, a 6-pro show here in Sony Hall. What would you like to see more at Boxing Insider Fight Night?
I mean, it's hard to ask for more at this point. We've just seen so many great fights. More heavyweights, I would love, you know, more women's fights, more of everything. Just give me more dates. I know we're doing a lot more, at least 2 or 3 more by the end of the year. It's been awesome to be a part of this. It's been a great night. We're playing Sinatra, New York, New York, so that means it's time for us to go. Henry, I enjoyed working with you once again.
It's always a pleasure, Dan.
For Henley De Leon and our entire production staff, Boxing Insider, Lou DiBella, Larry Goldberg, I'm Dan Canobio signing off from New York City. See you next time.